Xarelto continues to kill patients, while the FDA continues to ignore it. See the story at drugsafetynews.com.
Bernie Sanders recently called for an investigation into the crimes of the banks that helped sink Puerto Rico's economy, but most Americans had absolutely no idea what he was even talking about. But the crisis in Puerto Rico is one that we all need to be paying attention to, because Wall Street is trying to do the same thing here in America. And I have securities attorney Peter Mougey with me now to tell us what's happening. Peter, I've seen you talk many, many times with PAP about the fact that, you know, Puerto Rico's economy is in absolute shambles right now. And it's not just because of, you know, bad economics. We're looking at very much criminal activity taking place in Puerto Rico in the banking industry that has absolutely decimated an entire country's economy. You've spoken in the past about UBS's involvement, but now we've got more players in the game. We've got Banco Santander. Kind of give us a primer on what this new group has been doing down there.
The storyline in Puerto Rico for the last couple of years has been UBS, and all of the conflicts of interest. And UBS's client base was ridiculously concentrated in Puerto Rican debt and Puerto Rican closed-end funds, which defies every investment tenet, investment principle known to mankind. Now, fast forward to October, FINRA, the regulatory body, came out with a settlement agreement and Santander Securities that was primarily focused on Santander putting its interest ahead of its clients. And let me kind of give you a little bit more detail there. In Puerto Rico, the investment banks, the broker-dealers like Santander, have to put their clients' interest first, meaning their investor clients, mom-and-pop clients, who've put life savings into the advice of Santander. Well, Santander, as a bank or as an investment bank, a broker-dealer, has house accounts that they hold securities in. Well, Santander had over $100 million worth of Puerto Rican securities, municipal debt, in late 2012. And they recognized, Santander recognized, the increasing risks, the escalating risk that Puerto Rican debt was a major problem. And this is the end of 2012. And Santander implemented an action plan to rid itself of Puerto Rican debt starting in late 2012. This is before any decline. So it started reducing, selling out its debt. And in the beginning of 2012, it actually stopped taking purchases from its own clients, kind of like a market maker, thereby reducing the liquidity, making it harder for its clients to sell, but at the same time, selling its own exposure, oftentimes to its own clients, knowing that there was a huge tsunami coming. So they reduced its debt, or its exposure is a better way to put it, in Puerto Rican securities by over $100 million over the course of several months before the decline in September 13, when the Puerto Rican closed-end funds typically went down 30, 40, 50%. By that point, Santander was at zero, but its client base, mom and pop, Main Street, were left holding the bag and have now been decimated from holding the same securities, same types of securities that Santander itself got rid of.
And according to Puerto Rican law, this is illegal because, as you said, they have this fiduciary duty that they have to. They are required by law to put the interests of those clients ahead of any corporate interest that they have. And they just said basically to hell with it. We want to make money. Screw these guys.
The fiduciary duty is crystal clear in Puerto Rico. And fiduciary is a kind of a legal word, but all it really means is it's sacrosanct in the law. And it means that you have to put the interest of the clients first, meaning that it's usually based on superior knowledge, meaning that one person, lawyers, doctors, CPAs, financial advisors, somebody that knows more than Main Street. So that fiduciary has to put the interest of its clients first. It has to do its best in the interest of its clients. So in this case, Santander has this risk system that is crystal clear. It's green, yellow, red, and I'm sure you don't need me to explain it, but green is the least risk, yellow is kind of moderate, and red is high risk. So at the same time that Santander Securities was dumping its own exposure to Puerto Rican debt in late 12 and 13, the risk for Puerto Rican municipal bonds and closed-end funds remained at yellow, moderate. While it knew that the risk had changed and escalated, therefore it was dumping, yet it didn't change its yellow to a red, so its own financial advisors and its own clients knew. And what makes it even worse is that the clients down there in Puerto Rico, Commonwealth of the U.S., that they didn't own just little bits and pieces in diversified portfolio, but Santander, because of its conflicts of interest as an underwriter, an investment banker, had loaded its clients up in this, meaning it's very, very common for a Puerto Rican Santander client to be 70, 80, 90% concentrated in Puerto Rican debt. Santander knew of the escalating risk, knew that the yellow light had changed to red, but never told its clients, never changed the risk metric system, all the while dumping its own. So you ask me, is it illegal? Once again, and I don't know how many more examples we need, where is the DOJ? Where are the U.S. attorneys? Where are the criminal actions? Why do we see this conduct repeatedly? I've been in this business almost 20 years, going back to the tech wreck days and before. Where does it, when it, are the DOJ and the U.S. attorneys going to do the perp walk and put some of these folks in handcuffs and arrest some of these people for criminally for what they're doing to their own clients and violating the trust that's been placed in these banks with people's life savings? And Farron, it's probably people just like you know, whether it be your mom and dad or your grandparents, that you know they've saved $50, $100 a week out of their paychecks through their whole lives to see it evaporate in a matter of months because of a conflicts of interest and placing people's interest ahead of their own interest ahead of their own clients is just disgusting.
Well, you know, we have seen Senators Bernie Sanders, Senator right. Elizabeth Warren, they have said, publicly, we've got to look into some of this criminal banking activity that has taken place in Puerto Rico. The public greeted that with a giant yawn and what the heck's going on in Puerto Rico? I don't even know, but I probably shouldn't care. But I think what's important for people to understand is that, no, you may not live in Puerto Rico. You may not have money in Puerto Rico. But guess what? This can happen in the United States. And from what we've seen, it likely has happened in the United States. I mean, did I overstate that, or is
it
this?
It doesn't matter, Farron. It's the same storyline. It's different, maybe different music, but it's the same story over and over and over again. And I don't understand why. Fraud's cheap. Why doesn't the DOJ, why doesn't the U.S. Attorney's Office, FBI, why don't we see that at the end of the day, a few criminal prosecutions would have a significant deterrent of impact on this kind of greed and would protect mom and pop and stop this kind of 100-year problem happening every 2 years?
Wall Street is too involved in our politics. Many of the people at the DOJ came from big law firms that represented these banks. They sat in courtrooms next to them and defended these actions.
It's the revolving door problem. You and I have talked about that before. It's where the regulators go to Wall Street and go from Wall Street back, and it's this cozy relationship. None of the regulators or the U.S. attorney guys that want jobs on the other side are going to go too hard and ruffle any feathers. And kudos to the ones that do. We have a UBS financial advisor taking the fifth in his testimony, taking the fifth, I can't testify. How in the world, and supposedly there's an open criminal investigation, what in the world is taking so long? I mean, he's taking the fifth in civil, saying I can't testify because it impact my his right to defend himself in criminal proceedings. And it's been going on for months, if not a year. I mean, when in the world are we going, like you said, doesn't need to be everybody. But let's go after a few key players, and when an executive makes a decision that I'm going to line my pocket at the expense of my own clients, and I knowingly did it, and this isn't a matter of having a crystal ball and wondering whether the market's going to go down, but when somebody makes a knowing decision to line their own pockets at the expense of their own clients, it's time we hold a few people accountable criminally instead of these small little rinky-dink fines like $5, $10 million. Think about it. Santander had over $100 million in its house accounts that it wanted to get rid of and liquidate to protect from the impending decline. which it did, 40, 50%, depending on what types of securities, as much as 60. They save 40, 50, $60 million by selling ahead of its clients, recognizing the risk, not telling its clients, and they were fined $5 or $6 million. Fraud is cheap. It's cheaper to pay the fine and walk away than it is to get rid of it at your client's expense and have your clients bear the burden of the decline while you walk away scot-free. They save $50, $60 million, paid a $5, $6 million fine. Not a bad program if you're Santander.
We know the DOJ may not be doing anything about it, but Peter, people like you are out there. They're fighting the good fight. We appreciate everything you do.
Thanks.
Keep at it, and thank you for joining us today.
Thanks, Farron. Thanks for having me.